Christopher Hitchens, columnist for The Nation. Warren Strobel, who writes for The Washington Times, was here on Friday, and he has a piece in Monday's paper that starts off by saying, pressures are beginning to mount for the United States to bring the 18-day war against Iraq to a quick end, creating a political timetable that conflicts with the military's best judgment. In other words, maybe a ground war?
I think it's appalling in a way that people talk about deadlines in terms of days, weeks, and months, especially if they're talking the political deadline. The political engagement that the United States has made is one of appointing itself the arbiter of inter-Arab border disputes and of the Middle East region as a whole, uninvited, in effect, and without a proper debate. I would say when people ask me how long is this going to go on, I'd say something like 100 years. And it's not begun to sink in yet. At what point they decide that they have to dig the Iraqis out physically of Kuwait on a ground war, at what point that becomes real, seems to me a completely secondary question.
Morton Kondracki, what's your opinion?
Well, on a shorter time frame than 100 years, that story I'm sure refers to the fact that the Egyptian foreign minister was here and was worried about riots in the streets in Egypt. There is similar worry about riots in the streets in Malaysia and other Islamic places, which is what's putting the pressure on President Bush. My guess is that that we will keep the bombing going through February if we have to. Ramadan starts on March 16th. I think that he is not going to be rushed in by these Islamic countries into killing a lot of American boys unnecessarily, and is going to rely on the bombing as much as he possibly can to weaken them, if not to break them.
Before we go any further, let me ask you both, just in 30 seconds, to state how you feel about this American war effort. Chris.
Only got 30 seconds.
Well, I mean, you know, what I mean is just tell us how you feel we'll develop it during the half hour.
I think I'm against, since people are entitled to know that at the top of the show, what I'm against is the whole network of policies that have necessitated it and the network of policies that are going to be necessitated by it. That's to say, I'm against the United States appointing itself as the master of divide and rule in the region, changing sides, one day supporting Iran, one day supporting Iraq, being the patron of Israel's expansionism, being the patron of Saudi Arabia simultaneously, therefore of the worst kind of Islamic fundamentalism. So I don't think it's fit for the job. I don't think it has the right to be the replacement of the British Empire in the region. And I think its government has been lying desperately to its citizens about the scope and nature and origin of this conflict.
Morton?
Well, I couldn't disagree more. Unsurprisingly, I think that Saddam Hussein represents a menace to the region, to world order, that he is a hegemonist, that he wants to be a superpower using the oil wealth of the entire region, not just the oil wealth of Iraq, which he's already spent on weapons of mass destruction, but wanted to acquire domination over the rest of the Gulf, including the oil supplies of the world, and would use them to develop yet more dangerous weapons and policies to offset the West as a power. Not for purposes of the liberation of the people of the region, but for purposes of his own ability to tell other people what to do. He's clearly a murderer. He does not operate by even Islamic law. He operates by terror, and he would do the same in the region and do the same for the rest of the world. So he had to be stopped. And unfortunately, there is not a court of law that the Kuwaitis could go to and get a set of marshals appointed who would go there and roust him out of their home that he'd invaded. And so the only substitute for that is the United States operating in cahoots with the entire world. I mean, we've gone to the United Nations, we've gotten almost unanimous support for what we're doing, and the people in the neighborhood want us to do it. So I think I realize that there are complications, and some of them may be unforeseen, but I think there was no substitute for our doing it.
You have a piece in the February 11th issue of The Nation, and I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 George Herbert Walker Bushes. And they start off paragraphs and they end with linkage. What's your point?
The point is that he's got a very irritating name and he's a very irritating guy. And by the time you've read it 14 times, it's really in your face. And that he's a liar and a political cheat, and says that he's against linkage, against, in other words, connecting one issue with another, in a region where everything is conspicuously connected to everything else. And one of the examples I give, for example, is that a man who is capable of borrowing money from the Saudis in order to offer it to the Yemeni delegation to the United Nations in order to change its vote in the Security Council, unsuccessfully as it turned out, is capable of noticing linkage. And someone who is capable of doing the same to bribe Hafez al-Assad of Syria is capable of noticing there's such a thing as linkage in the region, too. So I make these various points.
The Syrian president now, took the money?
The Syrian president took the money. It worked in the case of Syria, though I notice even people like Morten Kondracki in his magazine are slightly embarrassed by the connection with Syria, which has used the money and the diplomatic and military cover that comes with it to annex a large part of Lebanon, with apparently the complete connivance and approval of the United States. You see, what Morten, if I can call him that, just said, he would have said whatever the country was that happened to be up now as enemy number one. The whole reason why Bush was pro-Iraqi until last August was because people were saying all the things that Kondracki just said about Iran. This war, in fact, is being fought partly in order to make Iran the master of the Gulf. It will be the clear winner. I don't know if that's the intended result. I don't know if it was the desired result. But the Iranians certainly see it that way and are taking the chance to establish themselves, in the case of an Iraqi defeat, to become the masters of the Gulf. Now, think back. Anyone who's watching this, wasn't it only a few years ago, the same sorts of people were telling you, we've got to do all this and all that to stop the Iranians. They're a threat, they're a menace. They don't even support Islamic law, as you put it, rather culturally, carelessly, I thought. They are murderers, they are a menace, and so forth. Now we're being told, and you hear it openly from soldiers and politicians, let's be sure we don't completely dismember and destroy Iraq, because there's a danger of that happening. Why? Because we might need it again. Now that's imperialism. You say we'll bomb it, we'll send cruise missiles into its capital city, we'll strangle its economy, all this kind of thing, but let's not completely shatter these people because we might need their country again for next time's power play when there's another official enemy. Now, I was against all this interpretation of policy by the United States before this began. I'm against this phase of it, and I'm against what is certainly going to be the result of it.
I think we made a mistake by supporting Iraq to the extent that we did against Iran. Iran was governed by super militant Islamic fundamentalists who were revolutionaries. President Rafsanjani is now trying to arrange a rapprochement with the United States. He's trying to mediate in the dispute. What we're trying to do here is to sustain a balance of power in the region between the various countries. It was not a good thing for the region. It was not a good thing for Western oil supplies. It was not a good thing for peace in the region to have Iran as a revolutionary power trying to destabilize and throw out the regimes in the area. And we did not enter the war. We did not fight on behalf of the Iraqis against the Iranians. We did tilt. We did supply them with intelligence and things like that. We were not actively engaged in combat. We did not provide them with rockets. All the weapons that Iraq is using right now are either French or Soviet.
Didn't they trade hostages with them either.
We were not actively engaged. We did not kill Iranians on purpose with our forces there. And so it is not the same that we were siding with Iraq. I think that because the highest level of this administration was preoccupied with other things and was frankly misguided, it stayed with Iraq much longer than it should have. It should have seen the menace of Saddam Hussein and begun to tilt policy. But look, balance of power is the way politics is played in the world, and it's been that way for centuries. And I think that it's the only way we can operate. The alternative well,
you
here, just
a second. You call it balance of power. I call it divide and rule. Certainly what you've been describing is better suited by my definition than by yours.
Look, we don't rule. We are not changing Saudi society. We are not changing Iraqi society. We're not changing Syrian society. What we're trying to do is guarantee some sort of stability so that the oil will flow. And the oil, by the way, is not merely a dollar versus $1.40 gasoline. It is the lifeblood of Western industrialized economies and all the economies of the world, for the Nigerians and the Tanzanians and the Bolivians and everyone else. So that if oil is high priced because somebody has his control on the spigot like Saddam Hussein, then it's poor people all over the world who suffer far more than drivers at the pump in the United States.
It takes a lot to make me cry, but I mean,
well, seriously, it's true.
The fact is, there's a huge international surplus of oil. What is of interest about this oil is that a certain group of people already own it, and they happen to belong to us. That's the point. Is that particular lot of oil? There's more oil in the Soviet Union than there is in the Middle East. We could, and indeed we should, if we weren't so monomaniacally obsessed with imperial control of the Middle East, be helping the Soviet Union develop its own oil industry, which, by the way, would have huge collateral political benefits of just the kind that are being ignored by Bush in his mad contest with Hussein. Look, the other thing is about the Middle East, you must have noticed by now, the interest of the imperial power is not in stability at all. The interest is in instability. It is in keeping people off balance,
of ensuring
weak regimes, and of making sure that there's no regional winners, so that you can play them off one against the other.
Look,
if you can't see that's been the pattern of the policy since at least 1953, when the United States overthrew the government of Iran, then you haven't been looking.
Believe me, the United States of America, you've lived in this country long enough to know this, would like nothing better than to have the Middle East resemble Western Europe. It would like the whole world to resemble Western Europe, where people are satisfied within their borders, where they educate their populations, where they concentrate on getting rich, and where they sell their products.
Why doesn't they treat them as if they were Western Europeans?
Because they're not Western Europeans. Because you've got people like Hafez al-Assad at times, and you've got people like Saddam Hussein who are willing to invade their neighbors. I mean, this is a country, this is a region that is still mired in ancient patterns, right? And they invade one another, and we have our allies, and we have our interests, and we're in there to sustain interests. And believe me, we are operating where we possibly can in the interests of peace and stability. We have never sided with the despots in this region on purpose to displace the others.
That's obviously untrue on its face. The United States pays the difference in military aid that is made in the Israeli budget between having a budget for Israel and a budget for Greater Israel. They couldn't finance Greater Israel, the occupation, without American aid. The same is true for the Turkish occupation of Cyprus, and the same is now, thanks to Desert Shield and Desert Storm, true of the Syrian occupation of Lebanon.
Your
intervention in the interest of stability and non-despotism.
Which country?
There is no country in Western Europe, now that Greece and Spain and Portugal are no longer dictatorships, that the United States would dream of treating as it treats countries in the Middle East.
Look, that is because the fundamental situation in Western Europe is one of democracy and stability and status quo. We supported that at the end of World War II with huge amounts of aid. We would support that now. Do you think we're not trying to destabilize King Hussein? We're not trying to destabilize anybody. We're trying to offset a destabilizing power who is trying to occupy another country, which he invaded.
This week it was that country.
Oh, come on. Look, you know, if we hadn't opposed Saddam Hussein, mm-hmm. we'd let him terrorize the whole region. You would be complaining about how it was somehow in America's interest to have this monster torturing children. You are just against anything that the United States policy is.
Well, it would be fair to say I'm against what it's almost certain to be. You're right in saying that I would have been saying that about Iran. And you're right in saying that I was saying that Saddam Hussein was a terrifying horror show well before last August, yes. But that why...
So was I.
Yeah, and so were you. Uncharacteristically, actually, for your faction, but you certainly were. No, you were. You were. I'm trying to pay you a compliment. You don't have to accept it. But Why was that? In other words, I mean, I'm really trying to get you to answer my question. Why these endless switchbacks of policy? Unless the policy is in some way flawed at its root, au fond.
Look,
my argument is that it is. Therefore, that to say, well, what are we for today? Are we for a ground war today, or will it have to be next week? And never to pause to ask, well, how on earth did that question get asked? If those are the answers they're now looking for.
We are for some reasonable stability. We are for countries not taking over the territory of their neighbors. Iran, under the Ayatollah Khomeini, was interested in toppling the regimes of the Gulf, the other regimes of the Gulf, and spreading Islamic fundamentalism all around the region. The neighbors, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and Iraq, all felt deeply threatened by the Iranian revolution, and we were allies of Saudi Arabia first, and we were partial allies of Iraq. Now, you know, don't overstate the extent to which we helped Iraq and Saddam Hussein during the Iran-Iraq war, and we did not build him up and tell him, please go and invade your neighbors on any American interest. You know that perfectly well.
In 1955, when the Saudi Arabians invaded the Barami Oasis, which belonged to Muscat, John Foster Dulles was in favor of it. The United States has been in favor of the King of Morocco's takeover of Western Sahara, of the Israeli occupation of the West Bank and Gaza, of the Turkish annexation of the northern part of Cyprus, and just to bring it to the current focus. Well, no, these are all statements of fact.
Oh.
Plain statements of fact. To bring you, it down
now,
to the
wait,
current,
just
to bring
stop,
it to the
just stop,
focus,
just
no,
stop.
No, because I haven't hit my stride yet. To bring it to the current focus of interest, is it not a fact that in 1973-4, the United States supported the Shah of Iran in an attempt to bring down the government of Iraq? Is it not further
no,
the case that the United States encouraged Iraq to invade Iran in 1980? These
no,
are all plain
not,
statements
not,
of verifiable fact.
It is clearly not true. We did not inspire Iraq to invade Iran. We do not support the Israeli occupation of the West Bank. If the Palestinians would agree to the Camp David Accord, had they agreed in 1979 to the Camp David Accord, they would probably have an independent Palestinian state right now. They refused. Now, I don't deny that the Likud
they
government...
They weren't asked. Camp David Accord was conducted over their heads.
The Egyptians were perfectly ready to help them out, to start the election process going, the autonomy process going. So were the Israelis. And that is why the right-wingers in the Likud party in 1979 opposed the Camp David Accord, because they could see that at the end of the road, 5 years down the line, there would be a Palestinian state. Now, the Palestinians threw it away. Every American government says that the
solution... So it's the Palestinians' fault that they live under military occupation.
In part it is,
and
because
they
will
under
not...
they've been curfew since
because
the 15th they, of January look, from 24 hours.
You cannot cite me one single statement wherein the United States says we want Israel to keep occupying the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. You can't cite one. Every American administration has been in favor of a land for peace deal.
Isn't
it
bizarre that it's American military aid that makes that possible, then? You don't need a statement. I mean, what speaks loudest? Now, you didn't, nor have you combated what I said about the occupation of Cyprus or of Lebanon or Western Sahara or Saudi expansionism, which was the first, actually, American policy in the Gulf.
In every single one of those cases, American diplomacy has tried to get a settlement in Cyprus,
in
Western Sahara.
In only one such case of 1956, when President Eisenhower, quite correctly, in my opinion, opposed the Israeli and Anglo-French attack on Egypt. As a matter of principle, at the United Nations, and in fact, was the reason why that invasion was not a success. It's now said by the supporters of Desert Shield and Desert Storm people like Henry Kissinger, and indeed, it's been said in the New Republic and sister magazines like Commentary that was a mistake. That Eisenhower should have let that go ahead.
And
I wouldn't be surprised. I'm not sure in which direction you're.
Well, I'm not even going to get into Suez.
No, I think I can see why not. That was the only stand on principle against invasion and occupation that's ever been taken.
Look, the United States does not go around the world invading other countries. You know, we are in the region there with the United Nations solidly behind us, fighting on behalf of a country that got invaded by another country. Now, look. I don't know what you would like the United States to do. I suppose it would be you would like us to be like, Luxembourg, and sit back and let the world flow along as it chose. Let despots control things. You would have liked the Soviet Union to dominate the world without resistance from the United States. It would have dominated Europe. Seriously, what is your alternative? For the United States to just sit back and do absolutely nothing and let the world flow along is going to mean that the strong will dominate the weak in every case, and butchers will run the world. Now, somebody's got to stand up for civilization, and it happens that gradually the whole world is becoming civilized. And what do you know? The whole world is joining the United States. It is adopting a capitalist economic system. Accepting democracy.
And
down the road, not very far from now, someday we are going to have a world filled with countries like there are in Western Europe, and it'll be because the United States extended itself economically, politically, and sometimes militarily to establish order and decency in this world.
Let me ask you this: what are your plans for Iraq? I mean, does the United States propose to, since the war aim is obviously now the defeat and destruction of the Iraqi government, it's no longer the recovery of Kuwait, since it's clear that this is now war with Iraq on all fronts, and that's where all the targets are, that's where the main target is. Do you have I'm just wondering whether you have a candidate, whether you know who's going to be the next president of Iraq? Well, you decided whether you're going to have a Western European society on the wreckage, or is there just another military client?
Look, I don't know what.
Someone
I'm
had
not
better
here
be
speaking
this.
For the Bush
Look,
administration.
Someone had better be. You could have fooled me. You're not speaking of the Bush
come
administration,
on, Christopher.
Someone had better be asking this question, hadn't they? Since we're taking on responsibility for the government of Iraq all of a sudden.
Look, we are not. Our purpose was, to get Saddam Hussein out of Kuwait. If Saddam Hussein gets out of Kuwait tomorrow, there will be continued sanctions, I would think, because to pay for the damage that he's done to the Gulf and to Kuwait. But we have not submitted a purpose of unconditional surrender. I don't think there is one. We're not going to invade Iraq. We're not going to take over Baghdad. We're not going to run the government of Iraq. I mean, if Saddam Hussein survives and rules at the end of the game, I'm sure that we're not going to go in and demand his ouster. You know, we may continue having sanctions in order to get.
If he's the winner, he'll be your next best friend.
No, I mean,
because after all, I mean, on the 25th of July, James Baker told his ambassador in Baghdad to instruct Saddam Hussein, the United States takes no position on your border dispute with Kuwait.
On the 25th of July, the ambassador to Kuwait could not get in touch with James Baker and went in on her on what she believed her instructions were. Read
no,
the papers.
Absolutely
it's not.
It
is.
No,
true.
No. I've read the transcript of that very carefully. She's a diplomat with a long record in the region. She said, I am directed by Secretary Baker in a interview with Saddam Hussein that she knew was recorded. I'm directed to repeat this instruction. We take no position. Furthermore, the statement as made was true. The United States did have and never had any position on a border dispute with Kuwait, which after all goes back at least 50 years.
Look, I'm not here to defend the Bush administration's behavior prior to August 2nd. Just a second. You know very well that the New Republic magazine and I myself wrote stories well before August 2nd saying that this man is a menace, that our policy against Iraq is wrong, that we should be resisting him, containing him, that he was dangerous to the neighborhood. So don't try to put Bush policy off on me because it's not acceptable. And he did not. The Bush administration made a terrible mistake by not recognizing the menace of Iraq, you know. But when the guy invaded another country, when he threatened to dominate the region, when finally they woke up to the danger, they tried to do what they could by containment. They said, get out. They got the whole world to join us in doing so, including your beloved Soviet Union. And now, you know, the guy is still there. So what are we supposed to do?
As you'll notice, I mean, the people who have to pay for these mistakes are the young people now stuck in the desert. And wouldn't it be nice for them to know that once this round is over, they won't have sacrificed just so there'll be another round just like it down the road? Now, it seems to me there's absolutely no guarantee of that at all. And that as long as the administration knows it can count on people who will say, well, we will dig you out of your mistakes. We'll be the last to hear. We'll just be able perhaps to squeeze in a quick congressional vote about a decision that's already been taken. We will put our bodies on the line, and we'll have all kinds of people at home who say this is great and proves that America's number one. That you're preparing for a whole round of disasters down the road. Look what happened, for example, yesterday in just two places. In Morocco, easily the most staunch United States ally in the region over time, 300,000 people. Not an easy place to have a demonstration either, in the streets in favor of Saddam Hussein. And that's on day 16. And in Jerusalem, the accession to the government, to the Shamir government, which was, in all conscience, I think you'll agree, sufficiently extremely conservative already, of an overtly fascist party that calls for the expulsion of all the Palestinians from the West Bank. Now, you see what's happening down the road in the Middle East, and all you've done is insert a large number of warm American bodies into it under an alleged subcontract from the United Nations, a mandate that's already been vastly exceeded by the cruise missiles falling into the center of Baghdad.
Look, now wait a minute. There, you can pack more misinformation into one sentence than anybody I've ever encountered.
That'll be on my next dust jacket.
Cruise missiles falling in the middle of Baghdad.
Yes. As it,
yes. Hitting what? Hitting the defense ministry. Hitting military targets.
The day before yesterday, just missing the American embassy.
Hitting military targets.
We have not systematically bombed civilian targets
in Baghdad.
If
and
it had
you
hit the American embassy, it would have been called friendly fire, I suppose.
It would have been called friendly fire, but it didn't hit the American embassy.
You are the sort of citizen governments dream about more.
Well, look.
You make their excuses before they've thought of them themselves.
Oh, come on.
A missile that can just miss the American embassy in Baghdad is presumably
it's
not.
A very accurate
missile. Is presumably not falling. The American embassy was presumably not built next to or in amongst Iraqi military installations.
How do you know what was next to?
Well,
when the PLO, your pals, the PLO, were occupying Beirut, Lebanon, they routinely put their anti-aircraft guns in hospital courtyards, you know, so that in order to get the anti-aircraft gun out.
That's because hospitals were military targets in General Sharon's. They learned very early on, don't put a Red Cross or a Red Crescent or anything.
Baloney.
I'm sorry, Morton.
You have to read the record of the invasion of Lebanon. You are such a cynic. Everything that somebody on our side does is automatically wrong and done for horrific purposes. You are just a permanent oppositionist. Well, against you, I would have to.
Well, this
Chicago, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. My question is about Kurdistan. Also, in the history, if you look, there was a lot of problems over there. And that's another part of having so many problems now. If they can, you'd just tell us about it, please.
Kurdistan. It's a terrible story, and it's part of what I've been talking about. The Kurds have the misfortune to live, just for those who don't know, can I take a second? I mean, they live in Kurdistan is where the borders of Iran, Iraq, Turkey, and the Soviet Union meet. It's a pretty awful place to have people who want self-government. In the early 70s, Henry Kissinger encouraged the Shah of Iran to use the Kurds to make war on the Saddam Hussein regime in Baghdad. The Pike Commission report for the U.S. Congress found that the Kurds had been deliberately used in such a manner as that they could not win their war, but they could provide a nuisance level of casualties, warm bodies of their own, in other words, to embarrass the Iraqis, and described it as the most cynical American foreign policy they'd yet investigated. I mentioned this because George Bush was head of the CIA around that time and sometimes says that one of the bills of indictment against Saddam is his treatment of Kurdistan.
Comment on the Kurds?
In this case, I agree completely with Christopher.
Houston, Texas, go ahead, please.
Brian, you have a very good program there. I've enjoyed it since the coverage has been going on. I had one question to Mr. Hutchins. He very aptly ducked the question that Martin asked him a while ago. Mr. Hutchins, what would you have us to do? And also, I saw you took liberty to mention the riots that's going on in Morocco, and I'm sure you hope they occur in Algeria and also in Egypt. But I'd like to hear your comments exactly. What would you have us to do? Thank you very much.
Good question. I certainly didn't mean to duck it. By the way, about the riots, they'll happen whether I want them to or not, and you'll notice. But to your point, look, there was always and there still is an alternative to this war, and that is the one that's been proposed by several countries long before the invasion of Kuwait, which is an international conference on the regional problems of the Middle East, which would have to include some address to the question of the Israel-Palestine dispute, which can only be settled on the basis of mutual recognition. The United States at the moment is the only major country that only recognizes and will negotiate with one side in that dispute, which means it puts itself out of commission as the benign mediator that Morton Kondracki imagines it to be. It would be possible to have, and it's been repeatedly called for, an international conference. If you go in at the other end and say, well, we'll fight each battle and declare each despot enemy number one as it comes along, you will be continuing, as I said, a long train of policies that have proven deadly failures.
What?
The international conference, it seems to me, is a formula for a mess, for a shouting match. And the solution to this problem is diplomacy, mutual recognition. It's a willingness on Israel's part, no question about it, to set a process going in good faith to negotiate with Palestinians and with neighbors. Now, as a result of this war, we actually may have the Saudis for the first time and the other Gulf Arabs and the Kuwaitis, when they get their country back, negotiating face-to-face with the Israelis over peace treaties, over guarantees, over arms control. That will be a major advance if it happens. Meanwhile, in Israel, in spite of the fact that this right-winger has been added to the cabinet, not, I might add, in a major portfolio, there is talk about a new offer to the Palestinians of elections and autonomy, and if the Palestinians are smart enough to get on the train, the train may go in the right direction if they're willing to live in peace with the Israelis.
San Diego, next. Go ahead, please.
Yes, I have a comment for both of the commentators. I am ex-military, and I have at least half of my family over in either Iraq or in the surrounding areas, and I do know what's going on over there, and I do commend you for what you're doing. But my basic comment and question is there's an old saying that says, two wrongs don't make a right. We are in this war, be it right or be it wrong. Why are there so many people, be it the commercial people or our politicians, who are just basically arguing? We should be in there now and giving our full support, no matter who we are, no matter what our stance is, because we have already started it.
All right, thanks. Mort?
Well, we are in support of our troops. There's no doubt about it, or at least I am. But you cannot. This is a country where policy has got to be debated, and policy will continue to be debated. That you can be sure that this is not going to be like Vietnam, where the troops, when they come home, are treated badly. They're going to be. They have the full support of Congress, and I think the American people. And as a matter of fact, look at the polls. The policy itself is supported by something like 80% of the American people, 75, 70, something in that range. So we're having a policy debate. We should have a policy debate. That's part of what they're fighting for over there.
Chris?
I'm a paid-up member of the Look Here, Just Hold On a Second party, which was founded quite a long time ago. In fact, it was founded at the point where it was discovered that presidents and kings and politicians can always get support for war once they've started one. But that's a very good reason for not stopping the argument when the war begins. Now, I know that there's an honest view held by a lot of people that says, well, now it's begun, let's get behind the boys and girls. I mean, you just have to see the huge hook that is sticking out of that bait. Many of us argued that there was no need for a war in the first place, and that if there was one, it would be a disaster, and that there were alternatives to it. All those three things remain true, and one despite the fog of censorship and obfuscation that the Pentagon has thrown over the scene, I think to the extent that we can, we are obliged, and not least for the sake of those whose warm bodies are being used for a failed policy, to keep the argument going, and actually, I would say rather to increase its pitch and range.
Wichita, Kansas.
Hello.
Morning.
Thank
Good
you.
Morning.
You know, I've just been listening here to the aggression that's occurred in the Middle East, and I wonder how great of a party we are to aggression when we can create a state of Israel and a Palestinian nation now, which is almost disintegrated and completely gone. And we consider this a nation that can be forgotten and no longer exists as a nation. And then we create an aggression into Lebanon by our support of munitions, et cetera. And we never take any responsibility to the fact that we have all these munitions being shot back at the Palestinians and the Arab nations. And as I noticed now, Israel is getting money now for the fact that the munitions and from coming in from Iraq now causing problems in Israel. Is it not any less a symbolism that we, in our own confrontation with the Arabs, have created our own munitions that's killing Arabs?
Mark?
Well, you're referring to arms sales. The arms sales, did not create the hatreds in the region. There's no question but what they ought to be limited. It would be nice, however, if there were a political agreement in the region so that that the various sides were not buying arms to hurl at each other. Now that the Cold War is over, it is just possible that the Soviets won't be selling on one side and we're selling on the other. We might now. Christopher may regard this as an act of imperialism, wherein we impose an arms embargo on these poor benighted countries so that they can't exercise their freedom to buy arms in order to kill each other. I'm sure he won't say that. I'm sure he'll say that it's our arms that we introduce to the region that are causing the hatreds that result in everyone's killing
much
each other.
Better, much better.
Yeah, right.
That's more nearly right.
Yeah. Well, the fact is that there should be some arms control, especially on weapons of mass destruction. We have armed the Israelis fundamentally because they were threatened by outsiders, and they asked for the arms sales. They had to maintain a military balance, and that's why we sold them. Now we've sold weapons to the Jordanians to defend themselves against the Syrians. We did not sell weapons to the Syrians. We sold arms to the Saudis, partly to defend themselves against the Iranians and the Iraqis. We did not sell arms to the Iraqis, and we have not sold arms to the Iranians since Iran's Cultural Revolution. So we don't sell to everybody.
Which Cultural Revolution was this? Since when in Iran? No American
1979.
Arms.
1979.
That's what I thought you must mean. Well, what was George Bush doing, meeting with the Israelis and giving arms to Iran in exchange for hostages? Or was that because it
no,
didn't?
No, that was that we did
was
that.
Was that not selling? It was giving.
You're quite right. You're quite right. My mistake. We did sell arms to the Iranians, and it was a stupid thing to do.
That's better. That's
connected in New York. You're next.
Yes, good morning, Brian. My question is directed to Mr. Hitchens. I don't dare ask a question to the other man because he's so biased in his answers, and I just don't believe in him at all, and I don't believe in his Republican magazine or newspaper, whatever. Mr. Hitchens, my question to you is this. If the United States and George Bush had confronted the question back in 1989 when he was at the UN about the Middle East problem with Israel and Palestine, would this not have prevented Saddam Hussein from using this as a crutch for invading Kuwait and then saying, this is why I did it? Thank you very much.
Well, first, I've got to congratulate you for being able to spot an impartial commentator in your seat. Second, look, I have to grant this much to Mr. Kondraki. Saddam Hussein was a menace to the people of Iraq and to his neighbors and had appalling ambitions and had behaved abysmally to the Kurds and to others and would have probably been doing that no matter what happened in the Palestinian dispute. However, so I don't want to be accused of being naive about that, and I really believe myself not to be. I've been in Iraq more than once, and I have some idea what I'm talking about. However, I do believe it's true that if the United States had stood for mutual recognition in the Palestine question and had directed its energies to a settlement of that dispute, that Saddam Hussein would have been punching air when it came to recruiting support from people outside his borders. The reason why he's popular now is not for anything he's actually done or could do. It's because he seems to stand against the American policy, which is viewed by all Arabs as the patron of Israeli expansionism, of the new Greater Israel. Now, the United States is officially, politically against Greater Israel, against the idea of it, as it must be, because it's against the acquisition of territory by force. It has it in its power to say to the Israelis, we insist you negotiate directly with the PLO. who are, after all, the designated representatives of the Palestinians, who are recognized by every other country in the world diplomatically as such. The only countries, incidentally, that don't do that are the United States, El Salvador, and South Africa, don't recognize the PLO as spokesman for the Palestinians. We've been arguing this policy for a very long time. If we'd been listened to, I don't believe there would be the appalling imbroglio that you now see.
Well, just to underscore the point that Christopher made, Saddam Hussein did not go into Kuwait on behalf of the Palestinians. He didn't say he did at the time. It was an afterthought, and he has used it cynically, as the Arabs have often used the Palestinians cynically, to defend his purposes. Now, everyone knows that the United States is going to go back at the peace process when this war is over and try once again to try to get the Arab states to talk to Israel, which they have refused to do up until now, and to try to get some sort of peace process going with the between the Palestinians and the Israelis. And look, if the Palestinians, the PLO remains sworn to eliminate the state of Israel. The PLO is, if the PLO had in good faith long ago said, we are willing to have a two-state solution here, we will live in peace with Israel, we will not engage in terrorism. If they had desisted from terrorism, if they had not murdered people in the West Bank in order to acquire power, they would have been a fit interlocutor for the Israeli government. The Israelis refused to talk to them. What are you supposed to do? You're supposed to force them to talk to somebody that they don't want to talk to, who means their destruction? It won't. And furthermore, look at the PLO has proved...
Peace does not have to be made between friends, Morton.
The PLO has proved what it's all about by siding with Saddam Hussein.
Windsor, California, go ahead, please.
Good morning, Brian.
Morning.
It's been about 6 years since I've called this show, but been a while.
Don't wait so long.
I would like to talk about long-range American democratic policy, in particular related to energy conservation issues and a new constitutional amendment. I would appreciate comments from either commentator about how I could articulate this in magazines like The New Republic or The Nation, social policy magazines. 10 years ago, when I called this talk show, I would raise the issue of legislation that would set up a national youth service program focusing on youth getting involved in energy conservation work as an alternative to a war in the Persian Gulf. I feel that if this program had been initiated through the bill that Congressman Pete McCluskey had installed, we could have possibly prevented this aspect of going to a war in the Persian Gulf. I think there needs to be a national debate on this, and I think by articulating and arguing for a constitutional amendment requiring mandatory community work or mandatory military work, that we could wake up this country and realize that there are numerous problems that need to be addressed, and one of them is a national energy policy, reducing our oil imports and finding alternative energy sources.
Okay, thanks. Let's deal with what his question is, and that is, if you have ideas that you want to lay down on paper and have people read, what would you recommend to him? And as a matter of fact, I wanted to take the time to show our audience, if you've never seen The Nation magazine, this is what it looks like. Christopher Hitchens works for this one, and Morton Kondracki works for this magazine, which is called The New Republic. This is not the newest issue, one that came out 2 weeks ago. What would you do? You guys started this some
the
time
The gentleman
in your past.
Who just called is very welcome to write to me at The Nation, which is 72 Fifth Avenue, New York, with any article he wants to be considered, and I'll make sure that it gets seen. I mean, I don't know whether I'm with him on compulsory service or not, but I do think it's remarkable that the president could make a State of the Union speech in which energy conservation wasn't mentioned, and where he confined himself purely to making Trumpful remarks and trying to sound like Winston Churchill, which I notice is his new and least attractive affectation.
What would you do if you wanted to get published?
Write to us at 1220 19th Street Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20036, and you can address it to me.
Is it hard, though? I mean, if you're just a citizen out there wanting to put your words on paper and get them published, is this is not easy?
Normally speaking, it's not easy, certainly not easy, but a good idea is always welcome.
It can be tough if you want to get paid for it, especially if you want to write for The Nation, which pays famously miserably. I mean, it's probably what you say, though, sounds like it's going to take more than more space than a letter to the editor would allow. So you're probably the only alternative is to submit a freelance piece. You know.
Los Angeles, go ahead, please.
Good morning.
Morning.
This is addressed to both individuals, and it concerns the change in our view of what's moral or immoral, given our technology. Now that we have these very accurate bombs, we consider civilian populations off limits. But if we look back a bit, when General Doolittle spent 30 seconds over Tokyo, we were delighted no matter where he dropped them. In a similar way, in the 1920s, Mr. Churchill, whom we all admired, made some decisions that we would not admire today, particularly with respect to use, which he didn't do for various reasons of mustard gas on the Iraqis. We really changed things to fit our advanced technology and our special position in the world. I find that perplexing, and I just like the views of both speakers.
Thanks. Morton?
I think we're using, if we were immoral, we would use our smart bombs to bomb hospitals and schools and nurseries and things like that. Instead, because we don't want to kill civilians, we use them to bomb military targets. Now, I mean, it seems to me that technology is available in the service, in the grisly business of war, of humanitarian instincts, and I think it's good. It's like, well, it's not like medicine, but technology is being used by and large by moral countries in the advancement of humanity, and in this case, I think even democracy in the long run.
Christopher?
God, you spare us nothing. Any minute now, we'll hear that it's not guns that kill people. Look, I mean, I'm not sure I accept the premise of the question. I have friends in Iraq, Iraqis, and also Western journalists who are there, and I have people who contact me one way or another about what the scene is in Iraq at the moment. We don't know exactly what's happening in Basra, but it sounds pretty grim. That's the second city of Iraq. It sounds as if it's been pretty much pounded. We do know, for example, of Baghdad, that it's without water for much of the week and almost without electricity around the clock. That's a civilian consideration, it seems to me, for a capital city that big and that complicated. It's cutting off the life support system for a civilian population and indicating the willingness to go further. We haven't started yet, and I don't think that the smartness of the weapon means that it's in any sense more humane. It may simply mean it's easy to take out the power station or the generator or the dam or whatever it is you happen to want to hit.
Columbus, Ohio.
Good morning.
Morning.
I subscribe to both magazines that are represented, and indeed got the nation's address from C-SPAN. And enjoy your columns very much, Mr. Hitchens.
Thank you.
And the New Republic. I read both magazines from cover to cover because they're not too big.
Admirable.
But with the exception of Fred Barnes, which is like having a fox watch a chicken coop to have him cover the White House.
That's not true. It's simply not true.
I don't have that many, although I think Willard Street and Dorothy Whitney would spin in their grave most of the time. I haven't been able to call since before the budget battle, so I'd like to make a few comments and then perhaps get a response. First of all, I oppose the war but support the troops. I often think patriotism is the last refuge of scoundrels, but I love my flag and support the kids. I don't think they should be there. I wanted to be an archaeologist, so of course it's terrible disposal of our stockpile of bombs on Iraq bothers me. Danziger had a cartoon in the Christian Science Monitor of a frightened mother with a baby, and the caption was, "Is this an Israeli mother afraid of Iraqi bombs or an Iraqi mother afraid of U.S. bombs?" That kind of sums up my attitude on carpet bombing. Thirdly, George Bush has done wonders with this international group he's got. He used the poor Christian people of Lebanon as pawn, turned his back on them, didn't cost him anything to get Syria. He will undoubtedly abandon the people of Cyprus to repay Turkey, and how that is going to help us bring any kind of a balance of power. Now, England isn't completely without blame, because when you look at the way they cut up all the lands, if they'd have given Iraq a port, maybe part of this could have been avoided. I am just wondering, and if any of you gentlemen could comment, why has no one interviewed this April in Paris, whoever she is? And I can't imagine, we kept track of Eric, what that poor man Brock, but we can't. Nobody seems to worry about April.
All right, thanks. What about that?
I've tried to call April Glaspie, and she won't. She's obviously been told by the State Department she's not allowed to talk to anybody. However, she did make one significant comment before she was silenced, and after the transcript of her discussion with Saddam Hussein was released. And the significant comment was this: we didn't think, she said, that Iraq was going to take all of Kuwait. I mean, we know that the Central Intelligence Agency knew the Iraqis were going to do it. And that they'd move troops to the border and so forth. And we've every reason to suppose that they told the Iraqis that was fine. I think they thought the Iraqis were simply going to straighten the Kuwaiti border in their favor, which you wouldn't have to do very much in order to give Iraq what it's long wanted and been denied, which is access to the sea. And I think Saddam Hussein, being the sort of guy he is, was a bit greedy about the green light he'd got, and also presumably wanted to grab himself something to negotiate over.
Morton, how do you view the April Glaspie controversy?
Well, I don't know what her instructions were. I don't know when she got her instructions. My understanding is that she tried, when she knew that she was going to go see Saddam Hussein, she tried to get a phone call into Washington to find out what the policy was. She couldn't get through. She went to see Saddam Hussein, and now, it seems to me that she should have said, we're against the use of force, we want you to settle your boundary disputes with Kuwait peaceably, and we will react sternly, strongly, if you use force. That, it seems to me that is overriding U.S. policy. She was not sent to be ambassador there to give him a green light to go invade the country. And I think it was an error on her part to imply, as the transcript does, that the United States didn't care whether he invaded or not.
Let me ask you a quick question about the New Republic. If this discussion were being held 20 years ago, would you two gentlemen be sitting on the same side of the table?
No. If I were working for the New Republic 20 years ago, let's see, what is that? That's not in the 1960s sometime. I'd probably be agreeing with him. But then again, I wouldn't be working there.
Think about that one for a while. Augusta, Georgia, go ahead, please.
Good morning, Brian. I'm absolutely overwhelmed at getting through after 2.5 years.
Nice to hear from you.
I have many things I'm interested in talking about, but my main interest this morning is to do with the news media, the coverage of the news media. I am most distressed as an old lady who went through World War II in England. I really feel that we are jeopardizing our troops and the conditions of fighting the war in Saudi Arabia, in Iraq. And I think I'm not alone in this. I think many, many people feel that there's too much coming out too soon. It's sort of, it overwhelms you. I've stopped watching the news except a couple of times a day, and your program in the morning, because there's so much that goes on, you just get absolutely overwhelmed with it.
Okay, thanks. There's a R.W. Apple piece in this morning's New York Times about the news media. We don't go through a program here without getting a call about the news media, and you can talk about it forever and ever. What's your reaction to what she's saying? Getting too much information, Chris Hitchens?
Well, I'm glad there is a channel, you know, or two where you can turn on whenever you want to see what's new. And I think that's a fantastic privilege. I think it does mean that people begin to think it's a long war when it's been 17 days, and start saying things like, I mean, even Morton, I think, was tempted into this on the McLaughlin Group, giving a prediction of how long it would last. I think you're out of time already on the first prediction. I'm well behind my prediction of 100 years. I think Morton said 13 days.
I said 13 days. My initial prediction was 13 days, that's right.
And I think you've updated it to 3 weeks, and you'll be climbing down from that too. I'd say it's the opening of about 100 years worth of conflict in the Middle East, where the United States will repeatedly find itself on the wrong side of an argument it started. And I wish one could focus on that and therefore bring some historic depth to the argument. And it's true that wall-to-wall coverage makes that tougher. If what you meant earlier by endangering was what I thought you meant, it is something you do occasionally hear from people, that they worry that the Iraqis are sort of planning their strategy through CNN and so on. All I can say is the Defense Department doesn't even make the allegation that there's any security problem about journalism in the region.
Peter...
And most of what you're getting is what the Pentagon wants you to see.
Peter Arnett, doing anything wrong?
No, I don't think so. No, he, look, I'm glad we have that little window into Iraq. It's good. It's good to see what they want the world to see. It gives us some reading about their moods and their propaganda and what they're putting over. Frankly, I'd love to see that we're not seeing. Well, there are lots of things I'd like to see. I'd like to have better reports on how we're doing against the Republican Guards. I think that is a material fact that has been denied for reasons that I can't quite fathom, except maybe the morale on our side. The Iraqis presumably know how badly their forces are being hit, so I don't understand why that's being done. But the other thing I'd like to hear what kind of Iraqi propaganda is going out to the Arab world, to the Islamic world, and what kind of propaganda, counter-propaganda, if any, is going out to the Islamic world from our side? Because it seems to me that the riots or the demonstrations, actually, they're not riots yet, in the Islamic world suggest that even though Saddam Hussein has violated Islamic law, that his point of view is getting over better than our point of view is.
Just a point on Peter Arnett, if I could. I mean, I'm a bit irritated by this repetition of it's what the Iraqis want you to see. I mean, whose idea was it to have film of cruise missiles, the cameraman or the person who fires the cruise missile? The Iraqis don't want us to see cruise missiles sitting in Baghdad. That's what we ought to be able to see. Peter Arnett, who I've once met and I greatly admire, it's interesting to remember, is the reporter to whom it was said in Vietnam by the American officer, we had to destroy that town in order to save it.
In this morning's Philadelphia Inquirer, there's a piece on Lieutenant General Tom Kelly, who we've gotten to know via television. He's from Philadelphia originally. There's a picture of him and his wife at Fort Myers here in the Washington area. Anchorage, Alaska, go ahead, please.
Yes, I wanted to thank the gentleman from the Nation. I'm going to subscribe to that. And I think that it's not propaganda in the Middle East. It's that they've dealt with us for years, and they don't need to have propaganda. We inflicted the Shah on them. And our territories here had to go to the UN to ask for protection. That was in the Congress in Morton. You should investigate. You're a reporter. I think that if you were to investigate these things, you couldn't say the things that you say. This administration, Grenada, that was a farce. The ambassador there said she was shocked at the lies that Reagan said for going into that place. And this is a time where we need good reporters. I had fear that you would be terribly attacked because the American people really have a problem hearing this. They don't want it, because if we open our eyes to it, then you have to do something about it. And people just don't want to hear anything bad about the country, but we're in serious trouble if this policy... I think it's like they want to take over a power of the world. I understand now there's something about we're going to have ATM cards instead of money coming up in the future, and that's quite a control. I just see
okay. All right, thanks. I think we get the point. She was saying nice things about you, and
yep.
Can't please everybody.
you also do a television program called American Interests. What is it? Who sponsors it? And what's the purpose of it?
It's PBS's foreign policy series. Check your local listings. It's on PBS. It's a foreign policy show. We interview policymakers. We try to stay ahead of foreign policy developments. And it's sponsored by Maytag.
Central Valley, New York, you're next.
Yes, I wasn't watching. I was just listening. And I heard a gentleman say that the United States doesn't go around invading other countries. Well, I would just like to ask the gentleman, what does he call it if it's not an invasion? Just in the recent past, there's been invasions of Panama, Grenada, Libya, Vietnam. If you go back in history, you find in 1909, 1911, 1923, 1926, we invaded Nicaragua. We invaded the Dominican Republic in 1916. We invaded Haiti in 1915. I mean, what do you call it, sir, if these are not invasions?
Mark,
now look. Does the United States go around occupying countries, invading them for no good reason, for reasons of territorial expansion, for reasons of ideological domination? Grenada, we are out of Grenada. We do not have an occupying force in Grenada. We don't have an occupying force in Panama. There was an election in Panama. The dictator threw out the elected government. He was menacing Americans in the region, and we did invade to throw him out. But you don't have this is not the Soviet Union, right? This is not Nazi Germany. We are not trying to exert military hegemony on any region, and you should know that. I mean, you know perfectly well that your country is not an imperialistic power. We are basically a status quo power. We would love that everybody in the world would live at peace with his neighbors.
You saw that the president, when he went to speak at the airbase in Georgia the other day, said that the thing about the war and the way it was going so well was that America now had credibility in the region and that what we say goes. That was his definition of his war aim. It's as if he worries, and I honestly think perhaps he does. You run into other people who do too. He worries that people in the region are worried that America isn't willing to resort to force. Now, I promise you, I go to the Middle East a lot. There's no one in the Middle East who wonders if the United States is ready to use force or not. They remember that it's only too ready to do so. They remember General Haig giving General Sharon permission to invade Lebanon. They remember the USS New Jersey firing shells as big as Volkswagens into the hills around Beirut. And they remember the bombing of Libya and much else besides. You needn't have any doubt on this score. There's no need for the president to worry about it. Everybody knows that America is capable of violence in the Middle East.
Well, let me just remind you that that when Secretary Cheney went to visit, Secretary of Defense went to visit Saudi Arabia the day after Saddam invaded Kuwait, that was the question. Was the United States going to really defend Saudi Arabia, or were we going to do what Jimmy Carter did and send a squadron of F-15s over unarmed? You know, when we said, no, we're coming here in force to defend Saudi Arabia, that's when he said, yes, please go ahead and defend us.
There was another question at that meeting, which was, would the Saudi Arabian government relax its opposition, which it had maintained over the last four presidencies, to having a permanent American military base on the Arabian Peninsula? It had always been opposed to having this station before. It won't be opposed to it anymore.
Oh, yes, it will.
This is what comes, though, of mistaking the credibility of America or the United States with the credibility of George Bush. George Bush's face is one thing, and it's a political question. He's made it now an international one, but it doesn't mean we have to do so.
Boca Raton, Florida. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Brian. You didn't have to work very hard to get the program going this morning, did you? This was
no problem.
You showed admirable restraint, Brian.
No, it's very enjoyable to listen to these two.
I have a proposition, Brian, that I'd like to put before these two gentlemen and have them comment on it. It's not frivolous at all. I really think it's our problem. A long time ago, a gentleman named Wilson, who happened to be the chairman of the board, I think, of General Motors, said that what's good for General Motors is good for America. I think we're living today under an administration and a political bunch of people who think that what's good for the military-industrial complex and big oil is good for America. One other comment. I'd just like to talk about the two magazines. I currently subscribe to the New Republic, and I think I thought I was getting the Nation when I put in my, I'm going to go for the Nation right now. I'd like to listen to your comments, please.
All right, thanks. Mort?
I thought when you mentioned the gentleman named Wilson that you were going to refer to Woodrow Wilson, because it seems to me that George Bush, when he talks about the New World Order, is more in the tradition of Woodrow Wilson than he is Charlie Wilson. The military budget, now that the Cold War is over, and prior to Saddam's invasion of Kuwait, the military budget of the United States was going to go down. It is going to go down. The army is going to shrink. Why is the army going to shrink? Because the Soviet Union has got its troops out of Europe. For 40 years, we have been defending democracies in Western Europe. We don't have to do that as much anymore, and so the military-industrial complex is going to take a deep hit.
In the discussion that Ambassador Glaspie, who we keep mentioning, had with Saddam Hussein at the end of July, when she said that the U.S. had no opinion on the border dispute with Kuwait. She has a very interesting little moment where she says to Saddam Hussein, they're talking about the oil price. She says, yes, we've got lots of people in America who wouldn't mind a higher oil price either, funnily enough. Many of them come from oil-producing states. That's probably why. And if you think of politicians like George Bush, James Baker, Mr. Mosbach and others, all of whom come from a background in Texas oil business, you can see that she's in effect giving a sort of profile of her employers. Mr. Bush, indeed, as well as being in the oil business in a small way, has also been in the arms business, admittedly as a freelance and illegally when he was vice president, but he's done a bit of arms trading on the side. And I notice in the State of the Union speech that despite everything Wharton says, with which I agree, about the end of the Cold War and the obvious absurdity of a superpower arms race competition with the Soviet Union, Mr. Bush did throw in a sop to the military-industrial complex by saying they were going to go ahead with the Strategic Defense Initiative, sneaking that in under the cover of a Star Wars option, under the cover of a war with a mediocre despotism in the Middle East.
In this issue of the New Republic, Morton Kondracki has a piece on his trip to Saudi Arabia. This was written, obviously, when you read it, before the war began. And in this January issue of Harper's, you have this inside article by Christopher Hitchens, Why We Are Stuck in the Sand. Leavenworth, Kansas. Go ahead, please.
Oh, good morning, Brian. This is the first chance I've had to call into your program. I like it very much.
Thanks.
Brian, I wanted to ask your guests there if they detected a certain amount of disparity in coverage, news coverage, between the ongoing military activities, of course, in the Middle East, and the four people from CBS who apparently, presumably with corporate approval, went ahead 2 weeks ago and what appears to be some sort of a grandstand play to beat CNN out to go ahead and get into the Kuwaiti military structure and talk to some people there.
Mark?
Well, I didn't know it was with corporate approval. I haven't seen anything to confirm that or to the contrary. Look, the reporters were chafing under the restrictions, and they decided to do what war correspondents have done forever, sometimes at their peril, in this case at their peril apparently, and go out and report the story independently. I don't call it grandstanding, I call it enterprise.
Chris?
I'd rather not say anything about the missing guys because I just don't know, but I know that there are some correspondents in Saudi Arabia who have been trying to do this. You often pick them up in the London press, actually. There's one particularly good one called Robert Fisk, who works for the London Independent, who try not to stay all the time with the pack or be corralled in the pool, and have got struck off on their own and gone up at some risk to themselves to the front line, often bringing back reports much less rosy, actually, than the ones you're getting in the New York Times.
Avon Park, Florida. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Brian, I enjoy your program very much.
Thanks.
And this is my first time calling.
Good to hear from you.
I have a couple of comments, then I have a question. I'm really surprised with the gentleman from the New Republic that he's not like Mike Kinsley, and I enjoy that immensely. And from the gentleman, you know, Mr. Hitchens, I'd like to know what country he's from and what political views he holds. Because he sounds like a communist. And my question is, just what should we have done? I'm going to hang up and listen now.
Are you a communist, Mr. Hitchens?
I'm an English-born socialist. Slightly to the left of Thomas Paine, who I noticed the president quoted in his speech declaring war when he said, these are the times that try men's souls. Like Mr. Paine, born in England, like Mr. Paine, claim the right to make a nuisance of myself anywhere I pay taxes. I think, do you think that'll cover it?
Well, yeah, and I want to ask Mort about Mike Kinsley. What's Mike Kinsley's position on the war compared to yours?
Mike was against the war, I think, is against the war. He thought that sanctions, he was not against going into Saudi Arabia to deter an invasion, but he thought that containment and sanctions could accomplish our purposes rather than war. It seems to me that he's wrong in that, because if Saddam Hussein has not gotten out of Kuwait under the kind of bombardment that he's under now, that he was very well not going to get out of Kuwait under mere economic sanctions, or that it would have taken 100 years for that to work. So we disagree, Mike and I, about whether the war was necessary.
Let me ask you both just a question. The printing press has been around for a long time, but back during the Vietnam War, you didn't have what now is four networks devoted full-time to news and public affairs, meaning CNN and the two C-SPAN networks. You didn't have the McLaughlin Group that you appear on, and the Inside Washington, and the all the different talk shows. Is there a chance that if you're locked into this discussion thing all the time, you're getting an overdose of it?
Well, I don't know, because we belong, both of us, to the in a sense, the most privileged class in America, the people who actually come on and give opinions on the air. So we can't possibly get enough of that.
But I wonder if this, can you hurt your psyche by sitting
there
out there?
There is no surface.
If I were a citizen, I would not be listening. I would not be glued. But they have the option of turning us off any old time they want, and when they've
let them try.
and you know, when you've had enough, just do something else. I don't think that everybody is sitting there constantly watching every minute of this war. I can't imagine that. People do have other things to do. They have jobs, and they have children, and they have movies to go to, and so on. So,
except CNN's ratings have gone up five times.
Well, people are interested in the conflict. They want to know what's happening.
Just a tiny comment. I don't want to sound self-pitying, but C-SPAN's very good about this in having a diversity of opinion. But I haven't seen on the air for a long time now anyone who has anything remotely like my own political opinions, which are admittedly minority views. But the impression of a unanimous war effort with everyone behind it and agreeing and understanding is given by a lot of the networks, and I know it to be incorrect, and actually we know it from the feedback from these telephones. I think if they want to make it a bit more compelling viewing, they could broaden the spectrum of opinions that they have on the air.
CBS, hire Christopher Hitchens.
Chattanooga, Tennessee, you're next.
Cry for help.
Yes, sir. I have a question, or basically a comment and a question for both gentlemen. It seems to me like both gentlemen are far extreme opposing each other. There are some agreements there, and it makes for a great show. But the main issue here is, why are we in Kuwait? Why do we want to get in Kuwait? We were asked, or the United Nations was asked by the Kuwaiti government and the people for assistance in getting, excuse the expression here, this madman out of their country. I mean, let's look at it realistically. What if somebody said, okay, we're going to take New York or London? What kind of a reaction are we going to get from all the people? Now, I realize that we have a lot of protests out there right now. We brought up Morocco a while ago. Well, let Morocco offer Saddam Hussein Morocco. Say, here, come over here, gentlemen, if you want the land. Here, guys, you know, I mean, I realize the government doesn't take the same point of view.
Chris?
I think this is a version of the argument that the president likes to put, which is that everything is basically Munich, and everyone who he doesn't like is always Hitler. And if we don't stop him in Kuwait, we'll be fighting him in San Diego and this sort of thing, which one's heard before and is going to hear again, and is obviously nonsense. Look, this border dispute with Kuwait is just worth a minute, perhaps, of our analytical time. As you know, it goes back a very long time. No Iraqi government, under any regime, and there have been a lot, has ever accepted the status of Kuwait as it was until August this year. It's been recognized by Iraq as an independent country, or was until August. But it's a long-standing dispute because the border that was drawn by the British colonialists in the person of a man called Sir Percy Cox was drawn in such a way as just to deny Iraq access to the sea. That was done in order to make it dependent on London as a semi-colony, which it was for a very long time. That's a long-standing source of grievance. It's exactly the kind of thing an international peace conference on the Middle East, which we've all been calling for such a long time on my side of this debate, would be bound to address. Just the kind of thing that is well within the wit of man to fix.
Disagree with anything?
And it was allowed to drift, and it was allowed to get out of control, and it provided an opportunity for playing off one side against another and being on both sides of it and selling arms to both and all the usual imperial racketeering. And now see where it's got you. A place that, I must say, by the sound of you, sir, I don't mean to sound rude, you probably hadn't heard of before August, is now consuming all your attention and making you think that you've got to make like Munich all the time or lose face. This is foolish and unnecessary.
Well, why we're there is that this border dispute was not settled by diplomacy, bilateral diplomacy between the Kuwaitis and the Iraqis. It was never put to an international conference. Saddam Hussein did not say, please let us have an international conference to settle this this dispute. He invaded. He not merely did not merely invade what he wanted, didn't get the islands or access to the sea. He dismantled Kuwait City. He killed innocent civilians. He sent his troops raping women of all nationalities, and he's virtually depopulated the country. He moved his troops down to the border, including his attack aircraft down to the border, as if to invade Saudi Arabia. Now, I don't know whether he was going to or was not going to. He has made speech after speech after speech saying that it is necessary, now that the Soviet Union is no longer a superpower, for somebody to balance the United States, and I am going to do it. And how am I going to do it? I'm going to do it by controlling the world's oil supply, and the United States will have to make a deal with me. Now, what has he used the oil wealth of Iraq for? It is a rich country. It's not a poor country. He has used it to assemble the biggest military in the Middle East. He has used it to develop weapons of mass destruction. He has threatened to use those weapons of mass destruction against Israel and others. Now, why are we there? We're there to stop Saddam Hussein.
Long Island, you're next. Go ahead, please.
This is for Mr. Hutchins. Please don't cut me off till I'm finished. Mr. Hutchins, why are we killing Iraqi people? They didn't kill any Americans. Why should they be killed for Israeli interests? Mr. Hutchins, I want to say this vehemently. If our masturbating Congress could see the facts as you do, we would never again engage in another war to kill American youth who should be leaders of our country in the future. But we have old men in Congress that are mouthpieces of the president, as is Mr. Carmack. I admire you tremendously. We need more men like you who see the whole picture as it is. Please.
All right, thanks. I got to tell our audience, because this is the third time it's happened, it's Mr. Hitchens. It helps to read those things on the bottom of the screen, and it's Mr. Kondracki. Any comment?
Not really, no.
Just want to leave it where it is. All right, let's grab a call.
I guess I quite like the self-abuse segment.
Where are you calling from, caller? Go ahead, please. Caller, where are you calling from?
Hello?
Where are you calling
from? Tucson.
Please go ahead.
Yes, my question is concerning the conferences that have been proposed and everybody's talking about. I'm wondering, is the attendance of the Iraqis, immediate attendance of the Iraqis, necessary? Why is it necessary to wait until the war is over for them to have conferences in the Middle East?
Mort?
Well, presumably a peace conference follows the war. It doesn't ordinarily go on during the war when we don't know what the balance of power in the region is going to be. If Saddam Hussein is shot by one of his military commanders for losing Kuwait, he may not have a seat at the conference.
Chris?
Yeah. There's a piece by Zbigniew Brzezinski in the New York Times this morning, and Brzezinski knows whereof he speaks, because it was he, in fact, who encouraged the Iraqis to invade Iran in 1979-1980, successfully, too, though it all got a bit out of control, so he now knows how wars that are supposed to be short can turn into very long ones. He says in his piece that it looked very much to him as if the United States had, in its negotiating before the war began, made it impossible for the Iraqis to climb down, didn't, in other words, want them to do so. I don't know whether he's right or not about that, but he certainly is in a strong position to be saying it. If that's true, the outlook's very sobering, because it means that nothing less than a complete capitulation by Saddam Hussein on all points, including what weapons his country is allowed to have. Another area where you notice Mr. Kondracki thinks the United States is competent to decide, though it's a country that is actually opposed to the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty and to the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, it's prepared to say we will unilaterally disarm Iraq. We'll decide what weapons Arab countries can have. This is an amazing arrogation of power and morality unilaterally by you, I think, and very, 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 very dangerous. The Arab League is not going to be spoken to in that tone of voice. They're not going to be told what weapons they can have, not unless it's part of a package for a peace in the region, and that would mean that the United States would have to speak in one voice about the acquisition of territory by force.
Los Angeles, go ahead, please.
Hello?
You're on the air.
Oh, okay.
Thank you, and you have a wonderful program. And I'd like to ask Mr. Kondracki if he could help Mr. Hutchins find
Hitchens.
A way.
It's Hitchens.
Hitchens, pardon me.
I'm used
Hitchens,
to it.
Although Mr. Well, let's not go into that. If he could help him get on some programs like the McLaughlin Report, or have his own program on KCET, because there really is a disparity in the balance of views. And I listened to the CNN with the Crossfire and Mr. Buchanan's group, and it would be very helpful if we had a really balanced view.
Thanks.
I have long thought that the world needed a Marxist columnist, and it needs a Marxist commentator, and I'm all for the network's putting Christopher on. Christopher's been on the McLaughlin Group a couple of times, I think, I'm all for his views being heard widely.
Is there
error deserves a voice.
Is there anybody else that's published in American media or on American television that comes close to thinking like Christopher?
Alexander Coburn, his colleague at The Nation, is the only who writes for the Wall Street Journal occasionally, is the only thing that's even close.
Do you have trouble getting on television?
Well, you know what Oscar Wilde said about Frank Harris, that he was invited to all the great salons and all the great addresses of London once. That's been my experience with TV shows. I mean, maybe it's something about me, something about my face, something about that. In fact, it was only once with McLaughlin. So this is getting embarrassing, actually. I mean, shows should not be about oneself.
But the question,
the point I was trying to make was that the spectrum of permitted opinion in America on mass market television, in particular, is very, very consensual. It's very narrow. If you can't, in discussing something like this war, use the word "we" for everything that's done, as if we are one and we're all agreed and it's all us and it's a family, you really aren't in the discussion at all if you have misgivings that go beyond "we". And I don't know of any other country in which the spectrum of opinion is so narrow. And I would now say that includes the public debate in the Soviet Union. It comprises a far wider range of opinion than in the United States.
Do you agree with him?
I think that the range of opinion in the United States allowed on editorial pages and that is narrower than it needs to be. I would like to see Christopher's opinions represented. I think that they would be rejected, but for very good reasons. But they need to be examined, and I think they ought to be expressed and given a wider audience than they have.
Monroe, Louisiana.
Yes, sir. I don't think that we should allow Peter Arnett to be Saddam Hussein's puppet. It was just a few short months ago that Saddam Hussein invaded the friendly country of Kuwait and pillaged and raped and plundered and, you know, just basically massacred the people there, and we're just furthering his cause.
In other words, you think that by having him there and having him report helps Saddam Hussein and hurts the United States?
Yes, sir. We're just doing what Saddam wants us to.
How does it
use Peter on that?
How does it hurt?
He's trying to influence the other countries to be against our allies and caused bombings and such across the different countries.
Chris?
Well, there's a man who wishes to be uninformed and whose wishes come true. Very easy. If all he wants is to be ignorant, it's a simple matter.
Martin?
No, I think even when Peter Arnett shows, or maybe especially when Peter Arnett shows that there has been civilian damage done, it enables us to know, to have a balance against the over-rosy descriptions of things issued by the government. The more information, generally speaking, you have, the better off you are. Now, if Peter Arnett is being taken to sites and being shown ostensibly civilian destruction, and he knows that this site is actually, has nothing to do with our attacks, and he reports that falsely, then he would be subject to criticism. But if he, in good faith, is reporting what he sees, even though he can't report everything that he sees, I think it's worthwhile. In other words, he should not be reporting knowingly reporting falsehoods, and I don't believe he is.
Last call for our two guests. Reston, Virginia. Go ahead, please.
Hi. Let's see. I'd like to make two comments. First, I'd like to hear the guest comment on what I feel is the shallow reaction that the press has in general in American media to following the White House line in terms of the news every day. It drives me crazy that the president says something, that's the in-depth report for that week and such. The other thing that really bugs me about this war is that the press seems to cop out all the time on the Byzantine world of arms procurement and how people are selling, you know, millions of dollars worth of arms all over the world, but nobody can do anything about it. We have intelligence agencies that can listen to phone calls anywhere, and they know bank transactions, but yet nobody can touch the fact that Saddam Hussein procured all these arms, and there's nothing they can do. Where's the role of national security? Where's the role of individual freedom? And where is it? I don't know. Thank you very much.
On your first point on the press, I went to Desert Shield for a while and was involved in this White House press plane and pool system and so on. And I worked out that the Pentagon has studied the schedules of the news media much more closely than the media study the schedules of the Pentagon. They know when people need their feed or their satellite or their press conference. They time it very well. It seems actually that the declaration of hostilities against Iraq was timed for the 7 o'clock news. And I think that we're in real danger of letting the authorities define the agenda, and of the press semi-consciously or subconsciously just taking its word for it. I remember, for example, it irritated me very much when George Shultz went on his tour of the Middle East. It was always reported as Mr. Shultz left on his peace mission today, or on the third day of his peace mission, Mr. Shultz said this or that. Now, it isn't a peace mission just because he says it is. But there was nobody's job, it seemed, to point out that was an editorializing implicit in the reporting, and it was simply taking the government's word for it. So I think the dangers of a spoon-fed press are actually increased by the high-tech aspects of things that allow the Pentagon to control the flow of news from Saudi Arabia. On your second point, wasn't it depressing, and I couldn't agree with you more, that when the Reagan-Bush administration, lyingly as it happens, said they were looking for moderates in Iran, suppose they'd been telling the truth, it seemed the only currency they knew how to deal with these moderates in was weaponry. That was the only means of exchange, the means of contact that anyone could think of. That's been the case for far too long, and the price for it, I fear, is going to be much heavier than we have yet allowed ourselves to suspect.
Well, of course, you know about what you know about arms sales around the world because the American press has written about it to some extent. You know, the Adnan Khashoggis and the other big arms dealers are usually the subject of some expose on 60 Minutes or such. So it's not as though this is all kept under wraps. And I disagree about the press. It seems to me that the press was against the war. That the press was in favor of the containment strategy. Peter Jennings, night after night after night after night, reported about how many casualties there'd be if we ever went to a war, and practically was delivering editorials on behalf of the Sam Nunn and the George Mitchell solution to the debate. So, if you were in the Bush White House prior to the war starting, I would not think that you would have said that the press was cheerleading for the administration.
Morton Kondracki is a senior editor for the New Republic. He's a regular on the McLaughlin Group over the weekends, has his own program called American Interests about foreign policy on PBS, and is a graduate of Dartmouth, previously reported for the Chicago Sun-Times, has had a radio show here in Washington back in the early 80s, columnist for United Features 83 to 85, and has been executive editor at one time of the New Republic. And by the way, I don't know whether this means anything, the New Republic sells for $2.95 and the Nation sells for $1.75. Chris Hitchens, the columnist for the Nation. He's also Washington editor of Harper's, formerly correspondent for The Spectator based in London, foreign editor of The New Statesman. Education at, is it Lees or Lies? Lees School at Cambridge, graduate in philosophy, politics, and economics from Oxford University in 1970, originally from Portsmouth, Hampshire, England. Where's hometown for Morton Kondracki?
Chicago.
And we are out of time, and I thank you both for this 90 minutes.
Pleasure.
To our audience, have a nice week.